Alrighty, it is now time to get into the next style period. Finally, lots and lots of music theory before we could really get started on the classical period. And let's start by remembering those dates, which is 1750 to 1820. And remember, those are always estimates. Music historians will come in and decide, yeah, you know what? We think it was actually 1745 to 1823. These are not set in stone. And this is one of the reasons that I don't require you to memorize these particular dates, because a new piece of research can come along and now the dates have changed. So, first thing to ask is what is going on in this time period? And that is the Enlightenment. That's the big one. And scholars don't actually agree on the exact dates of the Enlightenment. Most literary historians place the beginning somewhere between 1660 and 1685, and they will support the claim that it ended with the onset of the French Revolution in 1789. In a nutshell, the Enlightenment was social, philosophical, political, and literary movement. They believed in rational thought and the methodical observation of the world. This was a humanist and secular movement, which means the emphasis was placed on empirical evidence. Let's go back and let's kind of talk about how that all pulls together. We're talking about rational thought and methodical observation and empirical evidence. Empirical is something that I can see and touch, right? This is not me putting together a hypothesis about the structure of the atom before, there's electron microscopes to see it. I'm not sure if that's the best example. So it's also a humanist and secular movement. So humanism is very much a focus on human beings, on the accomplishment of human beings on the planet right now. And it was secular. So we're not talking about being on the planet as Christians to glorify God and to live a more Christ-like life. It is very much about what I can see, hear, smell, touch, taste, and focusing on me, 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 as opposed to things that I can't quantify. Okay, moving on. The American Enlightenment led to the American Revolution, which I could argue had a pretty good outcome. The French Enlightenment led to the French Revolution with beheadings. So you can see how some of the principles could lead to very different things depending on how history sort of played out. Okay, moving on. During the classical period, the political and economic power shifted away from the aristocracy, nobility, and it also shifted away from the church, right, to over to the middle class. Aspects of life during the Enlightenment that pertain to music are a few. The rise of the middle class to influential positions. That definitely pertains to music because the middle class was financially rising and they now had disposable income, which offered new possibilities. They wanted what were formerly only aristocratic luxuries, like going to the theater, being able to read literature, and music. Finally, public concerts are becoming common, which means the whole idea of patrons is gradually becoming unnecessary, allowing musicians to become financially independent. Takes some time, but they get there. The middle class also wanted to have music at home, too. So music publication became a new industry. Music became available for amateurs, like songbooks, keyboard music. And of course, remember there was no radio, there's no Spotify, there's no YouTube, so they needed some entertainment. There were also developments in musical instruments. Instrument sale and production became much more a thing. And then we have something really important. The invention of hammered string instruments in 1709 led to the pianoforte, which is what we now know as the piano, which means they could start to get gradual changes in dynamics instead of only using the terraced dynamics that we became accustomed to in the Baroque, which is a big deal. So in London of 1768, the first piano concert was given. Piano is so ubiquitous that it just seems like it's always been around, but it's not actually an instrument that's been around since the dawn of time. Okay? First piano concert was given in 1768. That's the blink of an eye in history. Musical and instrumental instruction became more prominent, and important books about musical instruction were written. So the wealthy middle class, upper middle class, could now afford lessons for their sons and daughters, and composers would consider the tastes of the middle class when they're writing new material because they want people to buy their music. So they started writing music that amateurs could play and understand. And they started writing comic operas instead of only serious ones. Remember, opera is still in its infancy, basically. In music, folk music and popular music tunes would show up in classical compositions. And composers got away from that figured bass, basso continuo, and they began to write out the parts. They realized the figured bass in more simple ways. And so you didn't have to be able to sit down and play figured bass, because that'd be it for me. I'd be done. I'm out of there. I'm sorry. So as we did before, when we looked at the Statue of David, for instance, let's take a look at how the visual arts changed in this time. First thing is a change from the contrast and movement of Baroque art to a lighter, more graceful style that we call Rococo. And so this painting is sort of light and fluffy. And one of the definitions says that Rococo depicted an enchanted world peopled by elegant men and women in constant pursuit of pleasure. That definitely kind of goes along the ideas with humanism, right? Where you're thinking about pursuit of pleasure but also it's very sort of elegant and high class. And by the end of the 18th century, the tastes are changing again. People began to think that the Rococo was frivolous, excessively ornamented, and lacking in ethical content. And so a new style in art was born called neoclassical. And we look at the word neo, which means new. So neoclassical art tried to recapture the simplicity and grandeur of ancient Greek and Roman art. Does this sound familiar? They can't find the answer in the present, so they turn to the past. Remember, when we talk about the Renaissance, it's a rebirth, right, of things that were, you know, older. And in neoclassical, we're trying to recapture something. So the neoclassical art emphasized firm lines, clear structure, moralistic subject matter, right? So if we take a look at some examples, here's the Death of Socrates, which is a noble depiction of the ultimate man of reason, Socrates. And he's literally in the middle of taking a deadly draft and he's lecturing his followers, right? He's like, before I take this poison, I want to teach you the things. Yeah, that's pretty noble. And you can see that there is it's not fluffy. It's not light and fluffy and little fluffy clouds and blurred lines. And just, it is very firm lines, very clear subject, and very moralistic for sure. Another painting we can look at called The Third of May depicts another moralistic subject, showing how Napoleon's soldiers executed Spanish hostages. Definitely not light and fluffy visual arts. So let's talk about the characteristics of the classical style and look at the different things that we checked before and see where things have changed. In the Baroque period, remember, we had some very basic things. We had unity of mood, terraced dynamics, we had the basso continuo, and we had the orchestra revolving around the harpsichord. So let's go through each of these and talk about what has changed, and then we're going to listen to a piece of music and listen to it for each of them. So instead of unity of mood, we are changing over to the idea of contrast of mood. We're definitely changing from the Baroque period into something different. Now we have contrasting themes within a movement, or even contrasts within the theme itself. The mood in classical music might change gradually or suddenly, but there's always structure and form to hold the contrast. So we've gone from unity of mood to contrast of mood, but there's always a structure to provide the nice clean lines and balance. Very important. Then we talk about rhythm, right? So before, when we were talking about rhythm, again, we have a flexibility now in rhythm that helps contrast the mood. So instead of one pattern repeated throughout, which is how we were getting unity of mood in the Baroque period, now we've got music that might have many different rhythmic patterns. So you might get unexpected pauses, syncopation, which is a new thing, and frequent changes from long notes to short notes, or vice versa. Okay, we're still going into the idea of contrast. Now let's talk about texture in terms of contrast. So the texture these days, in the classical period, is basically homophonic, but there can be fluctuations to provide contrast, and they might be sudden or gradual. Talking about melody, they're now tuneful and easy to remember and sing, and they are balanced and symmetrical. So remember, Baroque melodies were less symmetrical, they were way more elaborate and definitely harder to sing. There were still some great tunes in the Baroque period, don't get me wrong. Then if we look at harmony, again, looking at all the things that are contributing now to contrast instead of unity, we are now firmly in major and minor, which we have covered, major and minor scales and keys, and they are using dissonance to provide contrast, tension, suspense, and excitement. Very, very important stuff. So that's all we're going to talk about contrast there. Now we get into the dynamics, right? That was the second thing. Terrace dynamics, that was a thing. Well, now we have the piano. So there's great interest in expressing every level of emotion, which is now letting them say, okay, I'm going to use this new instrument as sort of my model. And we're going to think about using dynamics that could change gradually instead of terrace dynamics, right? So we have crescendos and decrescendos, where the music is going to get gradually louder or softer. And we're not just going to do this thing where we step up. It gets louder, significantly louder, or significantly softer, right? Now we're going to gradually do these things. And this is all new. Imagine if you've never heard music that gets gradually louder or softer before, and all of a sudden, you just like, wait, what did you just do there? So again, it's all gathered around the invention of the piano around 1700, is allowing composers to experiment and experience the gradual changes in dynamics. And the piano starts to gradually replace the harpsichord around 1775. And the three great classical composers mostly wrote for piano and not the harpsichord or the clavichord or the organ. So composers, instead of doing these sudden changes all the time, terrace dynamics, they could also do gradual dynamics, whatever they wanted to enhance the emotions of the piece even more. So let's talk a little bit about performance practice. Okay, use of the basso continuo gradually is abandoned, right? Performance practice. I'm gonna go back and talk about that for just a second. Performance practice is how are they doing the things, right? How are they doing the music? What was going on? What was typical? Well, basso continuo is gradually going away. And there is an increase in the number of amateurs, right? So that's one of the reasons, because an amateur is just like, can you just please write something out for me that I can actually play, please? So they needed simpler accompaniments, that's a tongue twister, because they were not professionals. So composers made it more simple and actually wrote them out. And performance practice, again, the piano is gradually being favored over the harpsichord, so we have that whole thing with dynamics. So we're going to listen to a Mozart piano sonata, and I want you to think about the things that we've just talked about as we listen to it and see if you can hear some of that. You know, things like gradual dynamics and the clean form and just contrast in general. Let's listen to it and see what we think. Thank you. All right. Now we're going to move on and we're going to talk about form in the classical period. Remember I said that the contrast of the classical period music was contained in a structure. So rules are important. They give boundaries over the journey, but still offer a lot of flexibility to the composers. So we're going to go over a few of the forms so that you kind of understand where we're at right now, and you're going to better understand where we're going as we move out of the classical period. So the forms we're going to look at are sonata form, theme and variations, minuet and trio, and the rondo. And we're going to start with the sonata form. You really have a great video assigned for this review, so I would like you to watch it. It is going to be included on the test, but I wanted to go into some specific things for class. So the first thing to remember about sonata form is not to confuse it with a sonata, which confused me to no end, and it still just kind of goes, wait, what? Sonata form or a sonata? So a sonata is a composition made up of several movements, like a piano sonata. I've played a few of those in my day. Sonata form, which is sometimes also called sonata allegro form, refers to the form of a single movement. So usually the first movement of a sonata is often in sonata form, thus the name. All right, some places you'll find sonata form. The opening, which is the first movement. It's usually fast movement of a classical symphony, a sonata, or a string quartet. You can find it in the slow movements of all three of these things, symphony, sonata, string quartet. And you can find it in the fast concluding movements of all three of these things. Okay, typical sonata form has three main sections: the exposition, the development, and the recapitulation. And I will say that there is some parallel with literature in the idea of exposition and then development. So let's take a look at what happens in terms of keys and in the idea of tension and resolution. So exposition sets up a strong conflict between the first theme and the second theme, and there could be like a group of themes. The first theme will be in the tonic key, and it's tuneful and it's memorable and it establishes home base. Then we have a bridge. It's a little transition, leads to the second theme. And there might be a modulation to new key to create a little bit of harmonic tension and kind of make it go forward, right? Music is always about creating some sort of tension and resolving it. So that tension moves us forward. So then we get into the second key or the second theme. It's in a new key, often contrasting in mood with the first theme. There's that word again, contrast. Then we get to a closing section in a new key, wrapping up the exposition in a neat bow. And there's usually a repeat sign where the whole thing is played again, the exposition. So you'll generally hear the exposition twice. Now, when I was playing sonatas or sonatinas as a teenager on the piano, my piano teacher generally left the repeat out, but usually if you listen to a professional recording, they leave the repeat in. Okay, from the exposition, we go into the development. This can be in many keys, and it's often the most dramatic section of the entire movement. It can move through many keys. We can have rapid modulations that heighten the tension. We can have themes broken down into little fragments or motives. So the development. So we've gone from exposition. So we lay out what are our themes, theme one, theme two, and then we go into development where we start to develop the themes. We start to do different things with them. We change keys. We break them apart. We change keys rapidly. Okay. But when your head is ready to explode, it's like, woo, we're going to do a recap. We're going to go over it again, a recapitulation, which brings resolution and relief. Because all that material that we previously heard is now in the tonic key. So we're going to go back and we're going to hear the first theme again in tonic. And then we're going to hear the bridge again in the tonic. So there's no modulation to a new key this time. We're going to hear the second theme again in the tonic. We're going to hear the closing section. It's going to wrap everything up in the tonic. Remember what I told you? Tonic dominant. Tonic is home base. So if we're not traveling away from home base, we don't feel that tension. We're staying in the tonic key. So we have exposition, where we're traveling to some new keys. We have the development, where we start maybe rapidly traveling to a bunch of new keys. Then we get to the recap. We're back to familiar ground with material, and it's all in the tonic, right? So it helps us to settle down and realize that, whew, everything's getting back to normal. And then maybe we'll have a coda where they might repeat some themes, they might develop them further, and it usually ends in the tonic. Not all sonata forms will end in a coda, but there you go. Now, I want to take a look at this in a different way, because we've just sort of had a table where all these things going on, and now we have a visual where we can see how it has stability in the exposition, and we continue in the exposition, and we start to create some conflict. Then we really ratchet it up in the development section. Woo! Emotions, emotions, emotions. And then as we get into the recapitulation, we get back to some stability and resolution of the conflict, and we might have a coda. So we've got all that in our heads. Whew. Let's listen to the first movement of a lovely Mozart piano piece that's written in sonata form, and see if you can pick out the different sections. All right, so we're looking at exposition, development, and recapitulation in the large term, but we're also looking at like first theme, second theme, bridge, maybe there's a coda. All right, let's take a listen to it and see what we think. Thank you.
Okay, I chose that piece because I thought it was really, really easy to hear those different sections. So hopefully that was not too confusing and you were able to hear those sections because you do need to understand sonata form, and we will be having an analysis on that coming up soon. Now let's move on to theme and variations. This form was widely used either as an independent piece or maybe one of the movements of a symphony, right? Sonata or string quartet. You could have theme and variations. So, just from the title of the form, what do you think it's going to sound like? Well, it's basically a musical theme or idea, and we're going to repeat it over and over, but we're going to change it a little bit each time, right? And we're going to notate this as A with a little, like A. And then A with a little boop, and then A with two boops, and then A with three boops. That's how it's notated, right? There's a whole lot of like alphabet and math that goes into music and discussing music. So each variation is going to be about the same length as the theme, and they're going to be unique and they might differ in mood. So we might do some changes in the melody or the rhythm, or the harmony, or the accompaniment, or the dynamics, or the tone color, right? We can get a lot of different variations on a same theme. So we're going to listen to an iconic piece by Haydn, for example. This is Symphony number 94. This is the second movement. It's called the Surprise Symphony, and you will see why it's called the Surprise Symphony when you hear it. So there is one theme, but it has two parts, an A and a B. And each is repeated, and there are four variations on this theme with a little closing section. So the changes that Haydn uses in this short little movement, he changes tone color, right? He changes the instruments. He changes dynamics. He changes the rhythm. He uses some faster notes. He changes the melody, sometimes with a little counter melody, and he changes from major to minor. So let's listen and see if you can hear the kinds of changes he is making. Thank you. So hopefully you were able to hear that familiarity of the theme coming back, even in the variations. Okay, next form, minuet and trio, often used as the third movement in symphonies, string quartets, and those other works. And it originated as a dance, very stately and dignified, in the court of Louis XIV of France. And here's a few things about this form in particular. It's in triple meter, usually moderate tempo, because we're dancing to it. It's in ABA form. And what does this mean? Well, the A is the minuet, the B is the trio, usually quieter, less instruments, sometimes a solo. And then we go back to the A of the minuet. So the name of trio originally referred to a tradition where three instruments would play this section, but classical composers didn't generally do this, but the name stuck. So minuet, trio, back to the minuet. And if we break it down further, we can see that the minuet section is broken down into a little miniature ABA. And then we get to the trio. We're going to call that CDC. And then we're going to go back to the minuet, ABA. And remember the little doop, doop, those little slashes basically says, hey, we're using the same theme, but we're changing it up a little bit. So we're going to listen to Mozart, Eine kleine Nachtmusik, and see if you can hear as it goes from the minuet to the trio, back to the minuet, and then those little repetitions within each section. One of my favorite pieces. Here we go. Okay, the last form we're going to look at is the rondo form. And a lot of classical movements in larger works will be in rondo form. And you might also see it as an independent piece all by itself. And you might see it combined with sonata form, but we're not going to go there right now. So it's basically a nice tuneful theme that is repeated several times, but then alternated with other themes. So it's an easy form to remember. A, B, A, C, A, D, A, E, A, F, A. We're always going to go back to A. A is that repeated theme. The main theme is usually very lively and pleasing and easy to remember, so you'll recognize it when it comes back. And it's usually in tonic with the other themes and other keys. So again, composers are using form and structure and repetition to help you figure out where you are. They're setting the boundaries and they're making the listening experience more pleasurable. They're helping your brain to find a place to hook onto. If you listen to a piece of music that is just constantly changing and never has any repetition, it's just this free-flowing thing, it can be a little hard for us to enjoy it. The one place where you're going to maybe hear that a little bit is in film music, but you're watching something on the screen that provides the structure. And we're going to study film music later a little bit. But I just really want you to understand that by the time we get to the classical period, composers are very invested in the structure and the rules, and they get very creative and they write amazing things within those structures because we need structure. We need rules. When we start breaking the rules, it can be fun. But as we gradually keep going, we can't figure out which way is up or down and how to start and how to finish. So as we get into further periods in music, we're really going to get into, like, they threw the rule book out for a while, but it got to the point where people didn't want to listen to it. It was just too, you know, chaotic, and there was nothing for us to just hook into. We like to feel that familiarity. So just kind of want you to really consider that. Okay, lots of sort of philosophical talk about the importance of structure and form, but now we're going to listen to this rondo form. It's really short. Thank you. Okay, hopefully you could hear how that establishes a theme, goes away, comes back, right? It's really, really easy form to recognize when you hear it, I think. So we're going to finish up for today, and I hope you have a fantastic day, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.